The doctrine of the Trinity is under more attack today than perhaps it's ever been. To give you just two examples, Islam is opposing the doctrine of the Trinity and accusing us of worshipping three gods. The fact that they think it's Father, Son, and Virgin Mary is simply a naive mistake. But they criticize severely Christians who are supposed to believe in three gods. Another group, even in the name of Jesus, is violently opposed to the Trinity, and that's the Jehovah's Witnesses. And I've had their usual booklet on this, accusing us of being heretics for believing that God is three in one. And I could go on. Feminism is making a huge attack on the traditional doctrine of the Trinity, so much so that I've got a book on my shelves called The Battle for the Trinity by Donald Blersch, one of my favorite authors, and to my astonishment, it's pretty well all about feminism and feministic theology and what's left of the Trinity after they've finished with it. So from all sides, the doctrine of the Trinity is under attack. The difficulty is that the church is not in a position to defend it. I have met many pastors, clergy, who just don't like preaching on Trinity Sunday, which is just past. It's the Sunday after Pentecost. So I'm hoping to make you stronger and more able to defend the Trinity after the two talks I've given you. Because the only real defense against all this attack is that Christians think clearly about what they believe and are able to talk about it and defend the faith once delivered to the saints, which Scripture exhorts us to do. Now, let me tell you what I hope to do today. In the first talk, I want to talk about the Bible and how this doctrine grew out of the Bible as we have it. But in the second talk, which will tax your brain a little more, I want to talk about the earliest centuries of the church and how they developed this. Some of our critics are very eager to point out that the word Trinity is not in the Bible. And they usually argue that it was invented as a doctrine later than Jesus, probably in the 4th century AD. Well, I want to begin with the Bible, therefore, and show you that this book of ours makes the problem quite acute. I call it a problem to begin with, but I'm hoping by the end of today, you will be rejoicing in the Trinity and thanking God for it and not regarding it as an embarrassing thing to defend, a bit like Alice in Wonderland believing six impossible things before breakfast. The Trinity is not given to us to argue about, but I want to make a case for you. Let's start with the Old Testament, which is three quarters of your Bible and consists of Jewish scriptures. And the one thing that we owe to the Jewish people is to believe in one God. And when you realize that most nations in those days had many gods, what we call polytheism, poly being many, theism being gods, polytheism, into that world when everybody believed in many gods came the Jews who believed in one. And from the time of Abraham onwards, they believed in that one God. And they believed they knew his name. In Hebrew, the name of God is J-H-V-H. The only trouble is that J is pronounced like a Y and V like a W. From those four letters, the British got Jehovah. And it's still used in some of our hymns. But as far as we know, the Hebrew word is Yahweh, using that Y and W. I have tried the hardest I can to get a Jew to tell me how to say that word, and they will not use it. They are so scared of taking the name of God in vain. And I just say to one, how do you pronounce that name for God? And they'll say, yeah, no, you're not going to get me. And they go no further than the why. So monotheism we owe to the Jews. And the nearest they have ever come to a creed is a verse from Deuteronomy chapter 6, which says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And that is the heart of the Jewish faith. That verse is probably the most important and the most widely used among them. I just want to say a little about that verse before I move on. One, the word Lord is not in it. Wherever you see the word Lord in capital letters in the Old Testament, you know that's where the name of God is, which they dare not say. Yahweh. So really it's, hear, O Israel, Yahweh, our God, is one. The next thing I want to say about that is that the word one is important because there are two Hebrew words for one. One means singular, one single thing or person. But the other Hebrew word, achid, means many, but who are one in harmony, in mind, one in thought. And that's the word that is used in that verse, achid. So it doesn't mean that they believe in one singular God, but it does mean that they believe in a harmonious God. That's a rather important point. The word one is used way back in Genesis of a married couple where the two become one flesh. They're still two persons, but their flesh has become one in harmony. It's not two separate individuals now, it's one. So they become the Pawsons or whatever. They are one couple. So even Deuteronomy 6 needs to be read more carefully. Now when you say you believe in one God, you are also saying you believe in the only God. One and only. And that is drawn out in the prophet Isaiah, particularly in the latter chapters, where again and again God says, there is no God beside me. He's the only God, as well as the one God. Other countries had many gods, but Judaism had one and only. But there are hints all the way through the Old Testament of plurality in God as against singularity. And there are only hints in the Old Testament which many Jews have not noticed and which other Jews are left perplexed by them. So what are these hints of plurality? One is that when God talks about himself, he calls himself us. And he does that right from the first page of Genesis, when he said, let us make man in our own image. Now, who is he talking to? Some Jews say he must have been talking to the angels, but we're not made in the image of angels. Others say, well, the plural is the plural of majesty, as when Queen Elizabeth gives her Christmas broadcast and says we instead of I. Do you know why she does that? It's because she's speaking on behalf of all the kings and queens we've had. We, she is now the representative of a long line of people, not just one person. We, the royal lines that have made our monarchy. But that's not true with God. God doesn't do it because of his majesty. He must be doing it because he's more than one. And it's not just in Genesis 1, it's in Genesis 11, where he talks about the Tower of Babel and says, let us go down and see what man is doing. And supremely in the call of Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 6, whom shall we send and who will go for us? Now that's just one of the hints in the Old Testament that though they believed in one God, there was just a hint that he might be more than one. And Jews have been puzzled by this. Next thing I want to mention is that the word translated God is the Hebrew word Elohim. And the intriguing thing about that is it's a plural word. El is the word for one God. Eloha is the word for two. But Elohim is a word meaning three. And so Elohim is used throughout the Old Testament for God, three. Now again, many people who don't know Hebrew haven't noticed that, and those who do have noticed it and been puzzled by it, but it's there. And it leads to some very odd grammar. The very first verse of Genesis 1 reads like this. In the beginning, God's Elohim created the heaven and the earth. Elohim, three. And you get the grammatical error of a threefold noun and a singular verb, because the word created there is singular. And that carries on right through the Old Testament. A plural word for God with singular verbs alongside it. Now again, looking back from a Christian point of view, that makes sense to us. Doesn't make sense to Jews. It's a grammatical mistake to use a plural noun and a singular verb. So there are all these complications in the Old Testament that give a hint of the Trinity as we know it. And one of the most outstanding is this verse which says, and the Lord, that's Yahweh, appeared to Abraham, and he saw three men. Did you ever notice that? So the Lord's appearance to Abraham was in the form of three men. That takes me back to one extraordinary occasion I had where Premier Radio asked me to take part in an experiment. And the experiment was to put two people together in the studio who had never met and who were as different as chalk and cheese and let them get to know each other. And they asked me to volunteer and I said, okay. And when I was introduced to the man who I would get to know, his name was Chris Lambrianou, a Greek who was a member of the Cray Brothers gang in East London. And you couldn't have had two more opposite people. But he'd found Christ. And you know, within 2 minutes, we were in love with each other. It was an extraordinary case. And we couldn't have been more different, either in race or education or anything else. Now, he was in prison for 15 years, most of the time in solitary confinement. And he was suicidal. So he was in a cell with an iron bedstead cemented into the floor, so he couldn't do anything damaging to himself. But he was in total despair. And someone gave him a box of books, and in the box was this book. And he thought, that's a Bible. I've heard that that does you good. So he decided to sleep on it. And he had the best night's sleep he'd had in years. He thought, this is a great book, it does you so much good. And he tucked it into his jerkin for the day and walked around with it for a day. And he got more and more interested because his life began to change. And then at last he decided to read it. And he read about the Lord. And one night, he woke up in the early hours of the morning, and there were three bearded men standing at the foot of his bunk. And he said to them, I know who you are. You're the Father, you're the Son, you're the Holy Spirit. And the middle one said, just follow me, Chris. And from that day, he gave his life to Christ and is doing great work, rescuing young men from the sort of life he'd had. And so the judges in the court where he does this say to young men who've got into trouble, I sentence you to live with Chris Lambrianou for 12 months. And at the end of 12 months, you can guess what the result has been. Now then, he had a vision of the Lord. In total ignorance of the scripture and everything else. And he knew they were Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's exactly what happened to Abraham. The Lord appeared to Abraham and he saw three men. Now we could go on like this, but the Old Testament leaves us with two huge questions about two people. First, the Messiah, the Christ in Greek. And the Messiah is right through the Old Testament. There are hints about him all the way through. But the question we're left with, are they expecting a human or a divine Messiah? Some passages suggest human. Some hint at divine. And only the New Testament gives the answer, which is both. But the Jews still argue about the Messiah, whether he's going to be a human like David or a divine. In the book of Daniel, it sounds as if he's going to be divine, even though he's called the Son of Man. In other books, he's a great king. So that's one question that we're left with in the Old Testament. The second question concerns the Holy Spirit. You can't decide when you read the Old Testament, is the Holy Spirit a thing or a person? An it or a he? There are many passages that speak of the Spirit of God as an it, a kind of force emanating from God that can come on people. And there are other passages which talk about grieving the Holy Spirit. Now, you can't grieve a thing. You can only cause grief to a person. And so there's an ambiguity in the Old Testament. Is the Holy Spirit a thing or a person, an it or he? Now, all these things I've been telling you are from the Old Testament, but can you see they're all pointing to the New? And in the New, the questions get answered, and the things are brought together that are separate in the Old. But that's the Old Testament preparation for belief in the Trinity. And it's there for eyes that are open to see. Turning from that to the New Testament, we find the New Testament is as strong as the Old, that God is one. No change to that. In fact, at least five or six of the New Testament writers quote Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And even Jesus himself quoted that verse. So there's no question about it that the God of the New Testament is as much one as the God of the Old Testament. No change. And though most of the writers of the New Testament are Jewish, they're not embarrassed to say that he's one. However, this is where the complication begins. They met Jesus. And at first they couldn't work out who he was, what kind of a person he was. And the Gospels faithfully record their perplexity. When he stilled the storm, they said, "What kind of a man is this, that even the wind and the waves obey him and do what he tells them?" What he told them, by the way, was not "peace be still." That's our polite modern version. What he actually said was, "Get muzzled." And it's the order you give to a dog that's jumping up and messing your clothes. "Get down." And that's what he said to the wind and the waves, as if it, talking to naughty puppies. And they said, "What kind of a man is this?" It took them 2.5 years to find out. Now let's look at what we call the Synoptic Gospels first. Synoptic means to look together, optic to see, sin together. And we call the first three Gospels synoptic because they're all looking from the same angle at Jesus, at what he said, what he did, and so on. Now the Synoptics are faithful to record that for 2.5 years, they just couldn't make him out. Everything he did puzzled them more. But at the same time, he was healing people, raising the dead, and casting out demons. And the demons knew who he was. And it's there in the record that again and again, when he battled with a demon who'd taken possession of someone, that the demon in the person would say, "I know who you are. You're the Holy One. You're this, that, and the other," but they were all right. But Jesus every time said, "Shut up. Don't say that." He wanted the disciples to come to their own conviction and not believe it because the demon said it. Demons are fallen angels. That's all they are. And they were, before anyone else, telling people who Jesus was. Have you ever noticed that? And Jesus didn't want demons telling his disciples, or anyone else for that matter. He was waiting for someone to say, "I know who you are." And he took them to a place which is my favorite place in Israel, and we've had the most amazing experiences there. It's at the foot of Mount Hermon. That's the big snow-capped mountain in the north of Israel. And the snow melts and goes down inside a crack inside the mountain and comes out at the foot a full-scale river that appears to come straight out from a cliff. It's an amazing place. It's called Caesarea Philippi in your Bible. And there, as you can imagine, was a lot of ideas as to who God was. To this day, there are niches carved in the rock which held statues. One of them was a Greek god called Pan. The place is still called Panias, after Pan. And he was a god who had appeared as a man in popular mythology. Another alcove had a statue of Caesar, hence the name Caesarea Philippi. Philip was the governor of the area, and Caesarea was Caesar. And he was a man whom people thought was God. And Jesus took his disciples one day to that very place where there was a statue of a god who appeared as a man and a man who appeared as thought to be a god. And he said, "Now, who am I?" But he didn't say that first. His first question was, "Who do people say that I am?" And they replied, "Well, you must be a reincarnation. You're such a great guy, and you're so young still. You must be a reincarnation of a great man, maybe one of the prophets." And Jesus said, "But I have this question for you. Who do you think I am?" And dear old Peter said, "I know. You weren't born here, you came from somewhere else. You're the Son of the Living God." And as soon as he said it, Jesus said, "Now I can go and die." He'd been waiting 2.5 years for just one person to guess who he was. And once they knew who he was, he could get on with what he'd come to do, which was to die. And from that minute, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. He said, "Now I can be crucified." And Peter said, "You'll do no such thing." And Peter argued with him. And Jesus had to say to one of his best friends, "Get behind me, Satan. You're not talking like God now. You're talking like Satan talks." Now then, Peter was the first man to realize the truth. How many of you know who was the first woman to make the same confession? Now, you only know because I've told you. Anybody else know? Pardon?
Samaritan woman at the well.
Sorry?
The Samaritan woman at the well?
No. Anybody know?
Martha.
Who said Martha? You've been listening to me as well, have you? Well, just turn a few pages over and you find that Martha, who was so busy in the kitchen, was the first to say, "You're the Son of the Living God." And now Jesus had what he needed, a man and a woman who realized who he was and who would tell others who he was so he could die for us. And very soon afterwards, that's exactly what he did. Now, he was very tender in the way he led the disciples to that realization. They didn't know then where he'd been born. They thought it was Nazareth, but it wasn't, it was Bethlehem. They didn't know then how he was born, because Mary had kept all these things in her heart, didn't share them. They didn't know anything about his boyhood at this stage. And so far as we can tell, they didn't know anything about his baptism. But at all those three points, his heavenly Father had a real place to play. And the word Father now comes right into general use. If there was one thing that Jesus did, it was to teach us to call God Father. And no Jew would ever do that. It would be presumptuous to call God your dad. Because the word he gave us was Abba, which is the first word a baby in a Jewish home learns when he sees that great monster leaning over the cot. And he says, Abba. And the proud father says, he called me, knows me, Dad. And Jesus had such an intimate prayer life that they asked him, teach us to pray like you do. And he said, well, when you pray, say, Abba. Come as a little child to God. I mustn't stop on that. I will have another sermon. But looking back over the life of Jesus, his heavenly Father was there all the way through. And I say his heavenly Father because he didn't have an earthly one. And only later did the stories of his birth come out. They were dug out by Matthew and Luke. And they show that from the very beginning of his earthly life, he had an earthly mother and a divine father. And from his conception onwards, his heavenly father meant everything to him. He was there at the conception. He was there in the birth. He was there in his boyhood. That's a story I love. It's the only glimpse we have of his entire life up to the age of 30. And his parents took him up to the temple in Jerusalem for his bar mitzvah, when a Jewish boy becomes a Jewish man, takes responsibility for keeping the law himself. Parents have that responsibility up to the bar mitzvah. And when they left Jerusalem, they used to walk their journeys in those days, 15 miles at a time. And what happened was, the children walked with their mothers on the way there, and on the way back walked with their fathers. They were now men. The women always set off first and put up the tent and cook the evening meal. This is how it could be. Nearly said how it ought to be. And then the men came later and caught up, had the evening meal. Now they walked 15 miles out of Jerusalem after taking Jesus there. And they did not notice that Jesus was with them. Why not? Because Mary said in her mind, he'll walk with the men now. He's a man now. And Joseph said, well, he's not my boy, so he'll stay with Mary. And you can understand how they both walked 15 miles and then discovered no Jesus. And you know the rest of the story. They went back to Jerusalem, searched everywhere but the right place, finally said, well, shall we try the temple? And there he was talking with the priests. And Mary said an interesting thing. She said, Jesus, where have you been? Your father and I have been looking everywhere for you. It means that she had never told Jesus who his father was. She'd kept it in her heart, secret. Amazing. But it means that at 12 years of age, or 13 maybe, he knew who his father was. And he said, but surely you know that when a boy has his bar mitzvah, he becomes a partner with his father in the family business. That's where you should have looked first for me. Didn't you realize I'd now come into the Father's business? It all makes sense, doesn't it, when you see the truth of it? But of course, it wasn't known to the disciples, even that boyhood. And then look at his baptism. The Father took part in that baptism. There was a voice from heaven. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And the people said, it's thundering. When God actually speaks out loud, it's like a thunderstorm. And if your ears are not tuned, you may not hear the actual words. But some people did, and that's what they heard the Father say. And this goes on all through his ministry. He says, my miracles, I'm doing them by the Spirit of God. And he kept talking about Father, but he never said, our Father. He told us to say that, but he couldn't say it himself. For himself, he always spoke of my Father and your Father. Made a very careful distinction because he was claiming to be the Son of God. That's what they were coming to realize. This is the Son. And as soon as you say the something, you're saying there's nobody else. When he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he meant there's no other way. There's no other truth. There's no other life. I'm it. Well, now all this comes out clearly in the Synoptic Gospels. His trial, he was condemned to death for blasphemy. Now, of course, the Romans couldn't crucify anyone without a charge on the Roman law books. And blasphemy wasn't on their books. So when they took Jesus to Pilate, they had to change the charge to treason. In the Jewish court, he says he's the Son of God. That was enough. Blasphemy. But in the Roman court, they said he is the King of the Jews. Treason. And so Jesus was actually condemned to death for blasphemy, but the Roman charge was treason, and he was put to death. And on the cross, he was for the first time ever separated from his Father. That's why he cried out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you left me? It's the cry of someone who'd never known separation from his Father. We need to get into the heart of Jesus. So that's how the disciples came to recognize that he was the Son of God. But wait, the one proof they needed was yet to come. They had confessed it now. They had said it. But something was going to happen that would settle it in their minds forever. He was put to death for blasphemy, and 3 days later, he was out of the tomb. And that means that God had reversed the verdict of the human court. The resurrection was God saying, you were wrong. He was speaking the truth. He wasn't blaspheming when he claimed to be my son. That was the truth. He was innocent, and you have convicted him wrongly. That's what the resurrection said to the disciples. And it was from that moment that they were absolutely sure that Jesus was the Son of God. Paul says at the beginning of Romans, he was declared to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead. It was God saying, that's my verdict. Well, now, so far, I haven't even touched on John's gospel. when we turn to that, the whole gospel is about one thing, that Jesus was, is, and always will be the Son of God. Right from the beginning, he had a new name for Jesus, because Jesus only got that name when he was a human being. But he'd existed long before, forever before. And so John gave him the name Logos. Do you remember, who was that film star, the lady who said, "So you got an ology?" Maureen Lipman, that's right. Did you see that advert? She's on the phone. "So you got an ology," meaning some relative had achieved a degree. It's the same word. And it was invented by a man from Ephesus. Logos. And it means the reason why. It was invented by a man called Heraclitus, who was a famous scientist, one of the first. And he said, the Logos is the reason why things behave as they do. So every part of study in a university is an ology. Zoology is the study of why animals behave as they do. Meteorology is the study of why weather behaves as it does. Psychology is why human mind behaves as it does. Sociology is why human society behaves as it does. Every ology is the reason why something happens. And it was surely the inspired move of God to John, the fourth gospel, to call Jesus the Logos, the reason why everything is. Amen. He is the reason why. And he says in the very first verse of John's gospel, the Logos was with God, actually face to face with God, and the Logos was God. And John's gospel begins and ends with people calling Jesus God. Now, if you've read my book, Unlocking the Bible, you know that there are three sevens in John's gospel. There are seven miracles. There are seven claims. And there are seven witnesses. Let's just run quickly through them. There are seven miracles in John, five of which are not in the gospel, the synoptics. And they are all more startling miracles, more divine miracles. And he doesn't call them miracles, he calls them signs. And each miracle he did was a sign pointing to God, changing water into wine. The synoptics never noticed that, but John did, because it was a sign pointing to the Creator. Healing a man who'd been 40 years blind, long time, and raising Lazarus after 4 days when his body was putrid and stinking, and he raised Lazarus. That was a God miracle, a God-like act. So there are seven miracles, all signs pointing to Jesus as God. Then there are seven witnesses who called him God, beginning with John himself in the gospel. The Word was God. Ending with Thomas, the doubting disciple, who said, first to say it, "My Lord and my God." And he was Jewish. And yet he was saying that without embarrassment, without difficulty, just spontaneously recognizing the Lord's divinity. The only two miracles that he follows the synoptics in is walking on water and feeding 5,000 people with a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread. All of them such divine miracles that they are signs pointing towards who did them. And then there are seven words of Jesus, seven claims, each of which began with Yahweh. Because we know the meaning of it, it's I am what I am. I am the great I am. And even in Greek, it's I am. Ego, I me. And I me means I am, but ego means I. So that a real translation of these seven claims would be I am. Begins with the bread of heaven, goes on through so many other things, seven things Jesus claimed. The good shepherd, the door, the way, the truth, the life, and so on. So seven miracles, seven witnesses, and seven claims to be I am. Now, you couldn't have much more than that. John's Gospel makes it quite clear. And when you get to the end of John's Gospel, he says, if everything Jesus said and did was written down, the world couldn't contain the books. But these have been written so that you may go on believing that Jesus is the Son of God. That's why he wrote the Gospel. Now, he'd been closer to Jesus than anybody else. And he'd been longer with Jesus because all the other 12 apostles had been killed. He was the only one who died of old age. And he was the one to look after Mary, the mother of Jesus. And Jesus knew that all the others wouldn't be killed. So he gave his mother into the care of John, the beloved disciple, who always sat next to Jesus when they sat for a meal. And he was surely the one to know what kind of a man this was. Now, I just present all this to you because with the Gospels alone, they had a problem. And the problem was they'd met two people they called God. As Jews, they knew about God in heaven, the God who brought them out of Egypt. They knew that God. But now they've got the problem. Jesus is God too. And yet they always felt that he was the same in nature and attitude and every other way. So much so that when he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, they just took that as truth. They knew they could see what God was like in Jesus. And so, if that was the end of the story, we wouldn't be Trinitarians, we'd be Binitarians. We'd be two in one God. But it wasn't the end of the story. They were going to meet a third person who was God, and it was the same God as the other two. Exactly the same. So let's go on to something else, the Holy Spirit. Now you remember I told you that in the Old Testament, they couldn't decide whether the Spirit of God was a thing or a person. And the same kind of ambiguity goes into the New Testament, because the Spirit in the New Testament is likened to wind and to water. That means they had an aquatic allegory for him and a pneumatic allegory, wind and water. And those are things. But John's Gospel takes it much further than that. In John 14 to 16, on the last night of his life before he died, Jesus told them about the Holy Spirit and called him he, not it. And he said, he will be another comforter to you. And the Greeks have two words for another. One is another like something, and the other word means another unlike something. But it's the word like something that he uses here. Another comforter, just like me. What I've been to you, he will be to you. In fact, he can't come and be with you until I go. And all this points to what we call the personality of the Holy Spirit. And he is going to be just like Jesus to the disciples. Another person just like him. And it's from John's Gospel again that we get the message about the personality of the Holy Spirit. Now, putting all this together, they've now met three persons, each of whom they've called God, each of whom is a real person to them, and yet it's the same God, exactly the same. Whether you're talking to one or the other, you get this impression you're talking to the same person. They have exactly the same attitude to you, exactly the same care for you. Here are Jews who've met three people whom they all know are divine and personal. And yet they are still Jews in believing in one God. And there you've got it. We haven't even touched the rest of the New Testament yet. And yet already we have found a solid basis for believing in a three-in-one God, which is exactly what the Trinity is. Now I must rush on. We come to the apostles and the epistles, the rest of the New Testament. And first of all, they are all absolutely clear that God is one. They even quote Deuteronomy 6:4 again. Five of them do that. We're in the New Testament now, and still the New Testament says God is one. But they also confirm first that Jesus was divine. And they attribute to him the three functions that only God has: creation, salvation, and judgment. And those are three things that only God does. And yet the epistles attribute to Jesus all those three functions. That's not a coincidence. Furthermore, they all take Old Testament concepts of God the Father and apply them to God the Son. God the Father was the first and the last, the beginning and the end. So is Jesus. There are at least 10 attributes of God the Father in the Old Testament that the apostles apply to Jesus in the New. He is now the light of the world. Let's go on from there. They all in the epistles acknowledge the personality of the Holy Spirit. And so that raises the problem. They begin to talk in terms of three. I'm going to just read two passages to you to illustrate that. First is from Ephesians chapter 4. Now listen carefully to this. make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit. Just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Do you notice the threefold? One Spirit, one Christ, one God. It's almost become natural to them to think in terms of those three in one. Just read one other passage quickly to you. 1 Corinthians 12. Where Paul is talking about the gifts of the Spirit. Now listen to this carefully. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. You notice that? The same Lord, the same Spirit, the same God. And we can go on like this, but I can't resist reading the last verse of 2 Corinthians. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now that goes through all the epistles. They put Father, Son, and Spirit together on an equality. They make no difference between them. And they use that threefold formula to bless people. Even more than that, there is evidence that they worshipped Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as well as the benediction I've read to you. And what I've tried to do in this first talk is to give you a feel of how the Trinity inevitably emerged from the experience of the disciples. And therefore they automatically thought in terms of God in three persons. They didn't use the word Trinity yet. I'll tell you how that came about in the next talk. But they were already thinking in terms of a triad or a triplet. There are many different words they use, but they were threefold in their thinking. And that's the heart of the doctrine. And I've just been signed that my time is up. So we'll stop there and go and have a cup of coffee or tea and come back as quickly as you can for the second talk.